Good morning, students. Now, yesterday we discussed about the variation of acceleration due to gravity with altitude and with depth with respect to surface of the earth, and concluded that the acceleration due to gravity value will be maximum on the surface of the earth, and thus force of gravity is maximum on the surface of the earth. Now, one more thing we would like to discuss here. That is about the acceleration due to gravity value which was calculated. It was calculated by Galileo for the first time by various activities. So he calculated the value to accurate value of about 9.8 meter per second square, almost whatever the value now we know, same amount of value he had calculated for the first time. G is equal to 9.8 meter per second square. G is equal to 9.8 meter per second square. This was calculated by Galileo. Then Henry Cavendish, using the famous experiment, calculated the value of gravitational constant, 6.67 into 10 to the power of minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square. Okay, then with the knowledge of radius of earth, radius of earth is given by 6.4 into 10 raised to 6 meter, that is 6400 kilometer. With these values one can weigh the mass of earth. That was first calculated by Cavendish. So Cavendish weighed the mass of earth. So we know acceleration due to gravity on the surface of the earth is given by gma upon re square, right? So with the knowledge of g, which was calculated by Galileo, 9.8 meter per second square, and with the knowledge of capital G, that is the universal gravitational constant, which was calculated experimentally by Henry Cavendish, 6.67 10 to the power of minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square, and with the knowledge of estimation of radius of earth, 6400 kilometer, one can calculate mass of earth, which was done by Cavendish for the first time. So mass of earth can be calculated as mv is equal to g re square by capital G. So if you substitute this, we get mass of earth 9.8 into 6.4 into 10 raised to 6 whole square divided by 6.67 into 10 raised to minus 11 gr square divided by capital G. If you substitute these values and calculate this, you are going to get mass of earth is going to be 5.9 into 10 raised to 24 kilogram, 10 raised to 24 kilogram. You can just remember 6 into 10 raised to 24 kilogram. This is how we remember mass of earth, almost 6 into 10 to the power of 24 kilogram. So this was calculated for the first time by Cavendish. Therefore we say that Cavendish weighed the earth. Cavendish weighed the earth means Cavendish found out the mass of the earth for the first time, 6 into 10 to the power of 24 kg. Now, with the knowledge of universal law of gravitation, and we know that earth takes 1 year to complete one revolution around the sun. Earth takes 1 year to complete one revolution around the sun. With the knowledge of mass of earth and the distance between earth and the sun, orbital radius of earth around the sun, we can calculate mass of sun. Now we will discuss weighing sun. How to weigh sun? mass of sun, right? Okay, once we found out the mass of Earth using acceleration due to gravity small g and universal gravitational constant capital G and radius of Earth. Now, next question, how do we weigh sun? How do we weigh sun? With the knowledge already we have, that is universal of gravitation, and next, the another one is the centripetal force. Okay, now let me draw the diagram. Here the given thing is, the mean orbital radius of Earth around the sun is 1.5 to 10 raised to 11 meter, that is 15 crore kilometer approximately. Then time taken by the Earth to complete one revolution around the sun is 1 year, as we know. Let us take 365 days. With these two given things, how do you find out the mass of the sun? That is the meaning of how do we weigh sun. Now let me draw the diagram. This is the sun. Let the mass of the sun be represented by ms, and let me draw the orbit of Earth around the sun. This is the orbit of Earth around the sun. This I will draw it as Earth having mass me. The distance between center of the sun to the center of Earth, we take it as orbital radius of Earth around the sun. So Earth revolves around the sun, let us say, in this particular orbit. Now the orbital radius is, let me take this orbital radius as small r as the orbital radius. This small r is here. Now the force of gravitation between Earth and sun, I will write first. Gravitation force between sun and Earth. Using the Newton's law of gravitation, we can write F is equal to capital G ms, mass of sun, into me, mass of Earth, divided by the distance between Earth and the sun, is also called as one astronomical unit, 1 AU. This is also called as 1 AU, one astronomical unit. Okay, now gravitational force between sun and Earth is given by universal law of gravitation. Now when the Earth revolves around the sun in a fixed orbit, there must be centripetal force. So centripetal force must be provided for the Earth to revolve around the sun. So I am writing the centripetal force, the force acting towards the center of the sun is called centripetal force on the Earth, on the revolving Earth, is given by Fc is equal to mass of Earth into V square upon R square, where V is the orbital velocity of the Earth and R is the radius of the orbital radius of the Earth with respect to sun. Okay, now here you write V is orbital speed of Earth, that is the speed of Earth in its orbit, with what speed it is revolving around the sun, that is given by V. Me V square upon R square, this is what we have learned from the previous topic, centripetal force. Now this centripetal force is provided by gravitational force, so we must equate this F with Fc. Centripetal force is provided by gravitational force, therefore F is equal to Fc. Substituting this, what do we get? G ms me upon R square is equal to then just write m e v square upon r square. M e is v square upon r. It is not r square. It is r. Correction. It is r. M v square by r. That is the centripetal force. V square by r is the centripetal acceleration. Now one r gets cancelled. M e also cancels. So we want to find out M s. Therefore, M s is equal to g comes to the denominator, r goes to the numerator. V square r divided by g, divided by g. We know orbital radius. Orbital radius is 1 astronomical unit, that is 15 crore kilometer. And we know gravitational constant already. And how to calculate p? We have to calculate v. V can also be calculated. Orbital speed of an object revolving about the center with radius r can be calculated by calculating the total distance covered in one complete rotation, total distance covered in one complete revolution, divided by time taken for that one complete revolution. Here, I will calculate here. V is equal to total distance covered for one complete revolution. Total distance covered for one complete revolution is 2 pi r divided by time taken. Time taken for one complete revolution is 1 year, that is 365 days, that is time period t. So time period t can be now converted into seconds because it is given in year. 1 year is equal to 365 days. So we must convert that 365 days into seconds. So substitute these values. So this becomes 2 pi r, r can be substituted. 2 pi r, okay, 2 pi into 1.5 into 10 to the power of L1 whole divided by 1 year. 1 year is 365 days into 24 hours each day into 60 minutes, 24 into 60 minutes in each day, and each minute has what? 60 seconds. So many seconds are there in 1 year. So these things are to be substituted here. So thus I will write here, substituting these values, v square. V square is becoming 4 pi square. 4 pi square r square. R square into r. R square into r divided by g. Now we shall substitute. Okay. Divided by t square. 2 pi r whole square divided by t square. So it becomes 4 pi square r square by t square. So t square will be there in the denominator. So now if you substitute, so this becomes finally 4 pi square r cube divided by g t square. Now substitute these values. 4 into 3.14 whole square into r cube 1.5 into 1.5 into 1.5 into 10 raised to 11 3 times. 10 raised to 11 plus 10 raised to 11 into 10 raised to 11 into 10 raised to 11 becomes 10 raised to 11 into 3. So it becomes 11 plus 11 plus 11. 10 raised to 11 into 3. 10 raised to 33. Whole divided by 6.67 into 10 raised to minus 11 into t square. 365 days into 24 into 60 into 60 whole square. If you calculate this, you can use the calculator or any other way we can calculate. If you use this calculator and do the calculation, you will get mass of the sun to be 2 into 10 to the power of 30 kg. 2 into 10 to the power of 30 kg. That is how one can weigh the mass of sun. Quite interesting. So with the help of the data, we can weigh the sun right at the place where you are sitting. That's the meaning of gravitation and the universal law of gravitation. Okay, now let us go to the next one, that is the gravitational potential energy. Gravitational potential energy. Okay, now we will calculate the gravitational potential energy. We know that the gravitational force is a conservative force. So, the work done by conservative force is definitely stored in the form of gravitational potential energy. Okay, now let us consider the smaller heights from the surface of the earth. If this is the surface of the earth, if the heights are considered to be very small, say suppose this is a height. Okay, this is height h1 from the surface of the earth. Suppose a point body of mass m is raised from height h1 to height h2. To height h2 from the surface of the earth. From here to here, the body is raised from h1 to h2. So definitely, the work has to be done against the gravitational pull. So this work done against the gravitational pull is stored in this body in the form of difference in potential energy. See, if this is taken as h1 and this is taken as h2, right? And let us take this position as second position and this position as first position. The work done from 1 to 2, work done from 1 to 2 can be calculated, right? Assuming for these smaller heights, the acceleration due to gravity to be constant and weight of the body to be constant. For these small heights, h1 and h2, we assume mg to be constant, that is weight of the body to be constant for small heights, smaller heights. H1 and H2 means here we assume G is equal to constant. As we have earlier assumed, acceleration due to gravity is assumed to be constant for smaller heights. But if you go to the greater and greater heights, then definitely acceleration due to gravity goes on decreasing. That we will consider little later. So how do you calculate the work done between H1 to H2 in lifting this? The mass M, the point mass m from position h1 to position h2. How do you calculate? So this can be calculated by force into displacement. Force into displacement. Thinking that this force is constant. Therefore, w12 now becomes force. Force is mg. And the displacement is h2 minus h1. Final position minus initial position. So this becomes h2 minus h1. Force into displacement. So this can be further written as mg h2 minus mg h1. So mg h2 is the potential energy at height h2 and mg h1 is potential energy at height h1. So this I can write as work done to lift from the ground surface to height h2. Work done to lift the point mass from the ground surface, we take this level as zero level, right? To height h2 minus work done in lifting the same point mass from zero level to height h1. This is the height h1 as I have mentioned. So it becomes mg h1. So that is given by w h1. So this itself, w12 is stored in the form of U2 minus U1, where U is being the notation used for the potential energy. So U2 minus U1 gives us potential energy difference. Potential energy difference. Potential energy difference. So U2 is the potential energy at height h2, and U1 is the potential energy at height h1. So at any general height, suppose it is raised to certain height, let us say to height h, general height h, from 0 level to this general height h, then what is the work done is calculated as mg into h minus 0. Mg h minus 0, that is 0 level, so we take it as mg h, and mg into 0 uses the potential energy on the surface of the earth. The potential energy on the surface of the earth, we assume that it is equal to 0. Mg h minus 0. So that's how potential energy at any point is given by mg h at height h. So this is for, already we have discussed in the earlier case also. Here it is in particular referred to gravitational force, therefore it is called as gravitational potential energy at height h, GPE, that is gravitational potential energy at height h. Now in case if the acceleration due to gravity is not taken constant, that will happen for greater heights. As you go to the heights of about 1000 km, 1000 to 1500 km, 2000 km, 2500 km, right, 3000 km, 5000 km, then naturally what happens? Acceleration due to gravity varies. Then weight of the body also varies. Then work has to be done against variable force. So there calculation of potential energy difference is different. So the equation for potential energy is slightly, it is different, because mg, this will no more be constant for greater heights. Let us check that one. Okay, now let us calculate gravitational potential energy at heights which are quite higher comparable to radius of Earth, where acceleration due to gravity will no more be constant. We know that acceleration due to gravity goes on decreasing. As a result, the gravitational force also goes on decreasing. Force is going to be a variable force. Okay, then work done in raising the point mass from position R1 to position R2 we want to calculate. Let us consider the point mass is at position R1 with respect to center of the earth. Initially at position 1, it is at distance R1 from the center of the earth, and it is to be raised to a distance R2 with respect to center of the earth. Work has to be done from raising from level 1 to level 2. How much is the work required to be done? If we calculate, that difference in work done is calculated as potential energy difference. Okay, now to calculate this, first we should know what is the gravitational force. Gravitational force is going to be a variable force. Let us consider at any position, suppose this is the position on the path, the gravitational force at this position, let us say at this position R, is given by Fr. Now if it is displaced through a small displacement dr, if it is displaced like this, suppose I am drawing it as level 1 and this is level 2 for clear understanding. Suppose this is the vertical displacement that is taken place from 1 to 2. Suppose this is any position where the position with respect to center is R, and here, from here to here, suppose it is being displaced through a small displacement dr. and at this position let us say the gravitational force at that position is R. Consider the point mass is at R1 position, is at R1 with respect to center of Earth, center of Earth initially. Then work done in lifting it, work done from 1 to 2, work done in lifting from R1 to R2, we calculate as W12 is equal to integration. So you have to calculate by integration method, because here the force is no more constant, force is variable force. So work done by variable force is given by F R dr, where F R is a force which is function of the position R from R1 to R2. This is a definite integral between R1 to R2, from position R1 to R2, what is the work done. So this is the point mass, don't understand that it is a zero here, this is a point mass, and this is the point mass which is raised to second level, right? So here it is raised from first level to second level. So FR, what is FR here? FR is the variable force. Let us assume that the force at position R is given by G M E M, where M is the mass of the earth, G M E M and M is the point mass, upon R square, where R is the distance of that point mass at any time t, at a distance R from the center, then it becomes G M E M upon R square, right? Now if we substitute this, we get integration G M E M upon R square into dr from R1 to R. So here we need to calculate the work done. This work done from position 1 to position 2 is stored in it in the form of potential energy, right? Potential energy difference between 1 and 2. So G M E M is constant. So take it out. G M E M constant, being constant, take it out. Integration of 1 by R square dr from R1 to R2. So integration of 1 by R square. Again, I suggested earlier itself, what is the integration of x raised to n? Here it is integration of R square. Integration of R square can, 1 by R square can be written as G M E M into integration. Integration. 1 by R square can be written as R raised to minus 2 dr R1 to R2. R raised to minus 2 dr R1 to R2. So this becomes G M E M into R to the power minus 2 plus 1, minus 2 plus 1, divided by minus 2 plus 1 square bracket with the limit, lower limit R1 and upper limit R2. So if you remember, I have used the equation integration of x raised to n dx is equal to n dx is equal to x raised to n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. This equation is
this equation is being used here.
So if you substitute this, thus we get W12 is equal to, so GMEM. So r to the power minus 2 plus 1 becomes r to the power minus 1, and in the denominator there is minus 2 plus 1, that becomes minus 1. So GMEM of 1 minus 1 upon r between the intervals r1 to r2.
Between the intervals r1 to r2. This is how we get the result.
Now, if you take out this minus sign, it becomes minus GMEM upon, okay, minus I have taken out. So this becomes first upper limit 1 upon R2, then minus lower limit 1 upon R1, 1 upon R2. Thus we get the result W12. I write it once again, W12 is equal to minus GMEM upon, I am splitting it, R2 minus, and minus of minus actually becomes plus, so don't write plus there, so keep minus as it is, so that I can plug this another minus GMEM upon R1. Yes, this has a meaning. So this gives you potential energy at second level U2, and this gives you potential energy at first level. So thus we get U2, that is U at, okay, I will write U2, that is better. Or we can write U at R2 minus U at R1. So this gives us potential energy difference equation. So this is what we write as potential energy difference. Potential energy difference. So if you look at any position R in general, so if it is at any position R, then what is potential energy? You have to just substitute minus GMEM upon R. That's it. So minus sign is to be remembered. So gravitational potential energy is negative. So finally, I can write here. So gravitational potential energy at any position R can be written as minus GMEM upon R. So gravitational potential energy is negative. So what does this negative sign symbolize? The negative sign symbolizes that
in between the unlike charges, there is always attractive force of interaction.
between like charges there is always repulsive force of interaction. So in order to show the force being attractive, we get the equation to be negative. And what is going to be the highest potential energy then? Highest potential energy is when r is equal to infinity. When r is equal to infinity, if you take the object to infinity, then potential energy becomes zero. So zero is the highest possible potential energy when the object is at infinite distance from the center of the earth. So we make use of these concepts in the further calculations. Thank you. Have a nice day. Bye.